Salvation Army here in Worthing have been doing this pretty much every Sunday for the past 130 years or so. A quick open air meeting and then they march back to their main hall. Notice is that no one is throwing anything at the band. No rotten eggs, no squidgy fruit, which is just as well, really. But it wasn't always this way. Back in the 1880s, when the Salvation Army first came to town, they met with fierce opposition. It seems unbelievable that the good old Sally Army could get people so wound up and angry that they would want to riot. I need to find out more. I'm told the man I need to speak to is historian Chris Hare, and we've agreed to meet by the Lido. So give me a flavour of what Worthing was like back in the 1880s.
It was a town that was developing as a seaside resort. So the pier was here, the railway was here, so they were bringing in day trippers, and then more affluent people would stay maybe for a week, so hotels were developing. And you had a professional class here, but you also had a working class here that was very traditional. And there was this undercurrent of drinking as well. Broken families, drunkenness, domestic violence. And I think that was something the Salvation Army picked up on. It wasn't just the East End of London, it was also these little English towns that had their problems. But it also had customs like Bonfire Night that was very riotous, quite anarchic, and could be perceived as pagan.
So the types of people that the Salvation Army were wanting to reach?
Exactly, yes.
So they come to town in September 1883 and they set up their headquarters nearby. Let's pick up the story there.
So this is where we've got the Salvation Army barracks, believe it or not.
What, that wall?
That little building there, it used to extend right across the road, so that's just a fragment that remains of the barracks.
So they set up a big location and base to say, here we are, we've arrived.
And in a very hostile environment, because the people living around here were the very people they were trying to get at, but also the very people who were hostile to them.
So when did the trouble start?
They came in September 1883. And they marched through the town with their band, and people round here and further up in town threw bags of soot at them, eggs, and it was even reported that some of these houses, people opened top floor windows and poured out chamber pots onto them. So really foul. So the hostility was immediate, and I think that was because of the big posters that they put up. And they declared the Salvation Army will attack Worthing on such and such a date. I think people took that as, who are these people? They're coming in, marching into our areas, so we'll resist them.
Now, the War Cry newspaper report this period as being very successful.
Well, I think they thought it was, because lots of people have come out into the streets, and they may have been hostile, but that was like evidence that these people needed saving. And they were drawing people who were sympathetic to the cause as well. So from their point of view, that was quite good.
But then that's not what the local newspaper says.
No, they just thought it was a shambles. And they caricatured them almost as half-wits. And I think they thought, well, they've been given a sort of bloody nose, metaphorically at this stage. Probably won't see any more from them.
And how long did this go on for?
This only went on for a few weeks because the hostility was so great that the then captain of the Salvation Army here in Worthing thought, no, we'll just stay in barracks, we'll have our meetings, but we won't do any more marching.
So it all stops for a little while.
It does. The change comes in April 1884.
With the arrival of Captain Ada Smith.
Yes.
A force to be reckoned with.
A force to be reckoned
with. And
then
everything changes. So this is where they would have thrown the chamber pot.
And then there were these obvious places where they really were disliked. So this is the Waterstones, but it used to be the Montague Hall in the 19th century. And this is where the Salvation Army had their evangelical public meetings.
And this is where Ada Smith was doing all of her stuff.
Yeah, she was the new captain appointed in the April of 1884, and she wasn't content just to be meeting here. She wanted to get out marching again, and she said, if the devil doesn't attack us, we must attack him. You know, drawing out those most in need of salvation.
So she was really responsible for taking it back onto the streets?
Totally, yes.
And as soon as they started marching again, they were attacked again, week after week. The mob now called itself the Skeleton Army, like other rioters in different parts of the country. But in Worthing, they singled out one man for the worst treatment, Mr. George Head.
He was clerk to the trustees of the Montague Hall, and he also leased, as we've seen, his warehouse to the Salvation Army as a barracks. And he had a shop just down the street here, which was demolished long ago. There's now a modern building on the site. But if we go around the corner to Bath Place, we'll see a building that looks very much like his used to. This street has some buildings from the Victorian period, and I think this one, 6A, looks very similar to George Head's shop, which of course no longer stands.
What was George Head doing for a living?
He was an ironmonger and general builder's merchant.
Why was he so interested in the Salvation Army?
Well, I think his own personal history. He'd been in trouble as a young man with the police, and we think that he even went to prison for a short time for petty larceny. And then some years later, he took an action against his own father in the local courts because his father was a violent alcoholic who'd been assaulting his mother. He became a very pious, religious man and a great opponent of the drink trade, a big supporter of temperance.
But the rioters really choose to pick on him, don't they?
They do, because they blame him for the Salvation Army being in Worthing, because if he hadn't let them have his warehouse as a barracks, if he hadn't have leased them the Montague Hall, it would have been impossible for them to continue in the town because no one else was going to lease them anything. So the mob came here, they attacked his shop, they threw stones through the window, all the windows were smashed, and it represented a very physical threat because he lived above the shop with his wife and his sons, which leads us now to the town hall and what happened there.
Salvationists came to the town hall to ask the magistrates for protection from the Skeleton Army. And as a result, summonses were issued to some of the rioters, but very reluctantly. At the end of proceedings on Wednesday, the 20th of August, one of the magistrates, Mr. F.W. Tribe, could restrain himself no longer.
He said, "The Salvation Army are doing the very worst they could possibly do. They are exciting blasphemy and ridicule and provoking disturbances, but unfortunately, they are still within the law."
Unfortunately.
Yes, and basically the magistrate's saying, you know, I wish I could ban the Salvation Army. And it's almost a green light to the mob to do your worst. And that's certainly how they took it. And not only were they on the streets in force themselves, supporters from as far away as Eastbourne were coming in by train. So by late evening, it's estimated there were as many as 4,000 people on the streets.
And how many Salvationists?
100 at the most. Okay. So they were massively outnumbered. The Worthing police force was a dozen police. So their police station was in Ann Street, just behind where the old town hall was. And the police barricaded themselves in the police station through fear.
The police didn't feel safe.
Oh, definitely not. And the Salvation Army barricaded themselves in their barracks in Prospect Place. And they were so fearful that they were issued with six-chamber revolvers, which they never used.
Salvationists.
The Salvationists armed. Were. In case it got to the really point where their lives were in danger. The mob went systematically around the town, attacking the police station, attacking the barracks, attacking George Head's shop. And eventually, the magistrates knew they had to act. And it was Lieutenant Colonel Wisden who came down here just before midnight, stood on the steps of the town hall, pleaded with the mob to disperse, and all the time they ridiculed him, shouting, "Apologise, apologise, you're offending the people," as if, how dare he? And he starts to read the Riot Act, and then Dragoon guards from Preston Barracks in Brighton trot into town with drawn sabres. And then they start to clear the streets. And then the police come out of the police station wielding their truncheons.
Finally.
And they lay into the crowd, smashing people to the ground arbitrarily. And a Swiss-Italian pastry cook called Salmondini who was standing outside his shop, probably to make sure it wasn't attacked, is seized by the police and they rain blows down on his head. And it's so serious that he actually dies a year later from the injuries he received.
And at this point, it's kind of not even about the Salvationists anymore.
No, I think it's mob mentality, this sense they could do whatever they liked.
So did things quieten down here after a while?
They did eventually, but not before some very dramatic events at George Head's shop. So we can go back there and have a look.
Let's go back. So this is a report from Bury and Norwich Post.
Yeah,
we're talking national news.
This spread around the country, what was happening in Worthing.
Wow. I love the way this is written. It says, two or three stones were thrown at the upper windows when Mr. Head appeared at the window on the first floor and, pointing a revolver through one of the holes in the glass, fired twice or thrice at the crowd. A young man named Edward Oliver was shot in the neck. Fortunately, the injury was not of a serious character, the bullet having glanced off. The crowd was terribly excited. Some clamoured for revenge, but Mr. Head stood at his window with a gun as well as a revolver, and no one had the courage to go near the house. I bet not. What happened to George Head after this?
Well, on the orders of the magistrates, he was arrested.
He's then arrested, yeah. Okay.
So you might have thought that a man who's having his property attacked, a man who's in danger of his property being burnt down when it's full of flammable materials, would be quite reasonable to use this force, but the magistrates were so hostile, he was arrested. And he actually appeared at the Maidstone Assizes, along, as it happened, with the leaders of the Skeleton Army, as if they were all equally guilty. And now the judge is having none of it. He sentences the leaders of the Skeleton Army to several months in prison. Whereas to George Head, he said, well, you know, you should never have been charged, you should never have been here, and completely exonerates him.
And is this the end of it?
No, not really. The hostility towards him carries on for some years later. The Salvation Army themselves are able to march when local tradesmen don white armbands to march with them, and they prevail to do that by some of the local clergy. Yes, and because they were known and respected in the town, the mob wasn't going to attack them in the way that it was quite happy to attack the police.
Well, there's a few loose ends I'd like to tie up. Let's go and sit on the beach.
Rightio.
It does seem extraordinary that a beautiful seaside town like this could have had near on 5 years of violence going on in it.
Yes, and it did keep percolating up. So when the Salvation Army laid the foundation stone for their citadel in Crescent Road in 1887, there were disturbances again. People pulled up clods of earth and threw it at them and tried to stop the ceremony taking place. But I think the typhoid epidemic that broke out in the town in 1893, 10 years after the riots, finally put to bed this hostility, because the Salvation Army did so much good work. Nearly 200 people died, nearly 2,000 people were seriously ill. A lot of people left the town, but the Salvation Army stayed here, and I'm not aware of any explicit hostility to them after that time.
Whatever happened to George Head?
In the first few years after the riots, he continued to be a hate figure. His shop was attacked on bonfire night in 1886, and it was only because there was a row of police outside his shop that they didn't break in again. He was declared a bankrupt at one point, but he managed to claw his way back. And when he finally died in 1900, people regarded him with high esteem. This is a quote from the Sussex Coast Mercury, that was a local newspaper. "We must have been very mad or very intolerant in those days. And none will grudge a tribute of homage to the man who, in an unpopular and persecuted cause, had the courage of his convictions and stuck to his guns in a manner worthy of an Englishman's most cherished traditions."
Oh, what a lovely way to end. Thank you very much, Chris.